Good morning. How's everyone doing? So welcome to the conference, which is designed to celebrate National Chemistry Week. This is National Chemistry Week, October 20th through 26th. How many knew that? This is for National Chemistry Week. It's not. Okay, so for all of you chemist heathens, you should just be glad that there are people like me who will assemble tonight in small groups and will indulge in the consumption of various solutions of ethanol. My name is Gerry Gray. I'm the deputy fire chief for the city of Reading, and also I'm the hazmat director for the 6-county SCHMRT team. I'm going to emphasize the T at the end. We are not Smurfs. We're SCHMRT. We're so self-conscious about it, we got rid of all the blue chemical suits. We don't buy them anymore. We're not the little blue people. We cover the counties of Modoc, Siskiyou, Trinity, Shasta, and Tehama. Big chunk of area. We're here to serve you. And today I want to talk about oil. Now, I don't think there's any dispute that oil has revolutionized our society. The products of oil are what we have made us today. So, although these other presentations are fascinating in their own way, if we had not found a way to bring hydrocarbons out of the ground, they would all be moot. So as you're filling out the evaluation paperwork at the end, I don't think it's a stretch to say this might be the most important presentation you sit through. It's all about oil. Bakken crude was a very, very hot topic until the virus. It was like my boss says, Gray, go to the Bakken meeting. Gray, go to the Bakken training. Gray, meet with the railroads. And then squirrel! Ebola. Everyone forgot about Bakken, but it's still a very huge concern for everybody. Let me give you a little primer on crude, just so we're all on the same page. So, where does crude come from? There's two theories. The first one is conventional. Dead things die after 100,000 years. Under certain pressures and temperatures, they form into oil. Most everyone accepts that. My battalion chief the other day says, so chief, you're gonna go talk about dinosaur blood? I pat him on the head. Oh, good boy, but you're not right about that. You see, the animal phylum, Chordata, which includes fish, mammals, birds, and reptiles, actually contributed nothing to the oil supply. Oil comes from small microorganisms. And he just kind of laughed and, okay, that sounds really good. So the truth of the matter is, oil comes from plants and small animals that have died over the millennia. It takes 100,000 years to produce in the ground, so it's not a renewable resource by our standards. Something else that's kind of interesting and is kind of capturing some media is a second theory. Now, in the United States, our culture works from, we have point A and we want to get to point G. And so we follow steps to achieve that. Russians don't have those constraints. They just do things. Why do you do it? We just did it. So they drilled holes in the ground, 15,000 feet down, wells. Why did you drill wells 15,000 feet down? We had the pipe. Guess what? They found oil. They found crude oil far below the strata and deposits that can be attributed to anything that's been living on this planet. So now there's a new abiogenic theory, which says that maybe oil exists in the center of the earth that has been chemically produced.
What is crude oil exactly? It's a mix of different hydrocarbons of different lengths. These molecules contain both hydrogen and carbon, and they come in all kinds of sizes and configurations. Depending on the mix of hydrocarbons, you might hear someone call a kind of oil light sweet crude or heavy sour crude. Heavy crude contains more larger molecules than light crude. Whether it's sweet or sour is determined by its sulfur content. Sweet crude has little to no sulfur. Now, we don't use oil in its crude form. We refine. That's how this works. Starting with the grab bag of molecules, you heat the crude up until it turns into gases. Then you pipe those vapors into what's called a fractional distillation column. As the vapor rises, it cools, and different substances, depending on their boiling points, condense into liquids. So up near the top, you've got gasoline and kerosene, with lighter molecules. And then down near the bottom, you've got lubricating oil and heavy gas oil. There's some more processing to finish off the products, but that's the basics. So what comes out of it? Let's break down one barrel of oil, about 45 gallons. The largest fraction becomes gasoline, 19 whole gallons. An additional 11 gallons become diesel fuel. But you can't forget jets. 4 gallons of every barrel go to aviation fuel. After that, you start getting into a bunch of weird yet still valuable stuff. Petroleum coke, liquefied refinery gases,
asphalt, lubricants, and other feedstocks. Just a little primer on crude oil. Hope you found interesting. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about politics and oil supply. First of all, how many of you heard the term peak oil? Peak oil is this theory or concept which seemed to suggest that at some point we are going to run out of the same capacity of oil. We won't be able to produce as much oil as we have. Very serious for economies that continue to try and grow and expand. In fact, you can see here this plateau corresponds exactly with about the time period that the recession hit. And there are many economists who feel that the concern over oil supply at the time was a contributing factor to the global recession. So here we are back in 07 to 09 period. We weren't able to extract any more oil. And then look at this, fantastic oil supply. This is all U.S. contribution. I wish I could tell you that our ship has come in as far as the economic stability of our nation's concerned. Certainly, we have found some major, major sources of oil in our country, and it will present itself in importing less from unstable or unfriendly other countries. But this is all dependent upon the global economy, and I'll get into that a little bit. Look at this quote. The United States overtakes Saudi Arabia and Russia as the largest oil and natural gas producer. Folks, we have vast quantities of these natural resources in our country right now, and we figured out how to get them out of the ground. In 2014, we're producing 11 million barrels of oil every single day. 11 million barrels. And all the peak oil predictions now seem to be invalid. And the reason for this is a new type of drilling called fracking. How many have heard of fracking? Okay, so fracking is not without controversy. If you're a geologist, you might be concerned about potential earthquakes. If you're a hydrologist, you might be concerned about water pollution in underground aquifers. Let me get to this, and I have a little video on what fracking really is. So, Larry mentioned gas prices being pretty low. Actually, Californians are enjoying some really low gas prices right now. What's going on? It's a massive economic chess game right now. So we're producing a ton of oil, in North Dakota, South Dakota, and Montana. And the OPEC countries are producing a ton of oil as well. The OPEC countries would like to see us stop producing oil. Well, how are they going to do that? Well, if they can get the cost of a barrel of oil down to close to $70 a barrel, our companies in the United States are going to shut down. It's no longer cost feasible. So when I say that I wish I could say our ship has come in, we have the oil, we just may not have the economic incentive to pull it out of the ground. We may still be dependent upon foreign oil, depending on how this shakes out. When you go to the pump and you say, wow, I love these new oil prices or gasoline prices or diesel prices, there's a part of our country that's saying, I hate this. U.S. production is expected to reduce our dependence on oil imports to 22%, the lowest in 45 years. That all depends upon the global economy. All right, so here it is. If you haven't heard about the Williston Basin, it's a giant ancient sea. It's centered over North Dakota. It takes in a chunk of South Dakota, a little chunk of Montana, and some of Canada. But the main chunk of this contains an area that we call the Bakken region. So the Bakken Shell region, we've known about it forever. Shale is a deposit in the earth that's very, very difficult to extract things from. It's rock. We've drilled through shale before, but it's very expensive. So this is what we used to do. We drop a drill bit down vertically, and then we'd extract a little bit of oil. Then we got to drill another way, and we got another vertical shaft, and we extract oil. Those all cost a lot of money. So we've come up with some new advances in horizontal drilling. We can actually go down, and then once we get to the target shale, we can drill horizontally. Got a nice little video that demonstrates this, because what you're doing here is you're fracturing up, thus fracking, you're fracturing up this deposit. When you fracture up that deposit, it may have some geologic concerns, it may have some hydrology concerns. I'll leave that up for some other presentation, but right now, it's the way we're pulling oil out of.
At the site of natural gas recovery, a vertical well is drilled approximately 6,000 feet straight down into the ground through several layers of earth and rock until the shale layer is reached. While drilling the well, the drill is kept cool and lubricated by pumping a pressurized mud solution down through the drilling pipe, through the drill head, and out of the three jets. This also maintains the wellbore stability and removes the cuttings up and out of the well. Once the drill reaches the level at which the shale is located, the drill changes direction, and the hole is drilled horizontally approximately 1,000 to 3,000 feet into the shale. When the drilling is complete, the mud solution and cuttings are sucked out of the hole, and the drill is removed. Steel casing is then fed the entire length of the well. The casing is then secured in place by cement that is pumped down through the pipe and up the outsides of the casing. The cement is pumped under pressure to the end of the pipe so that there is no cement within the inside of the casing. The drill is then sent down the casing where it drills through the cement end and into the shale. Once again, the mud solution and cuttings are sucked up and out of the well, and the drill is removed. A perforated pipe gun is then sent down and out of the casing and into the newly drilled section of the well. Explosives are then fired from the gun through the perforations and into the shale. Fracturing fluid, primarily a mixture of water and sand, is then pumped from the surface facility down the well bore and into the fractures. The fractures crack, expand, and branch out, allowing the natural gas to be extracted more easily. The fluid is then pumped out, and the fracturing gun is moved in reverse down the wellbore. In multi-stage fracturing, a plug is installed before the entrance of the recently fractured area, and the process is repeated. The fracturing and plugging process is repeated the entire length of the wellbore to maximize potential natural gas extraction efficiency. Once all the fractures are completed, the plugs are drilled out, and the natural gas is able to flow, allowing for extraction. The natural gas is then pumped up the wellbore to the surface facility for processing.
So they're talking about natural gas, but oil is the same principle. So now you know what fracking means. We take a deposit in the earth and we just break it up into little pieces. What happens to the deposits above that? Well, sometimes gravity collapses that fracked area. Oklahoma, Texas, we're seeing earthquakes in areas that have no history of earthquakes, and it may be attributed to fracking. We don't know yet. This is all very new. So on one hand, I'm here to say, this is great. I love the thought that we can pump American oil out of the ground. But on the second hand, it's not a free gift by any stretch of the imagination. I think we still need to pursue renewable resources, but for the time being, fire engines and ambulances and police cars don't run on photosynthesis. They need to have oil. So here it is, in its splendid glory, the Bakken Shale. A massive area. Right over here is pretty much the heart of it. North Dakota, South Dakota and Montana, and a chunk of Canada. And they are pulling oil out of this area like never before. In the last 5 years, 4,000 new wells have been drilled up there. People in North Dakota are making fortunes. It's the new gold rush, if you would. And I just saw a documentary last week on CNN about the Williston Basin and what's happening there. If you go to Williston, North Dakota, a 600 square foot studio apartment now rents for $2,400 a month in North Dakota. That's worse than San Francisco. But this is where money is being made right now, as long as it's profitable. Doesn't matter how much oil we have, it matters how much economic incentive there is to pull it out. Right now, there is some economic incentive, but every day, as this glut on our global supply increases and our prices keep going down, and they will, this becomes more tenuous and less economically feasible. Used to be a time when a sheikh in Saudi Arabia sneezed, gas prices would go up. Look at the complete disarray that ISIS, Syria, and all these other things are happening in the Middle East, and there's seemingly no impact at all on the prices of oil. And that's because of this area right here in good old USA. All right, why is he talking about all this stuff? Let's talk about Bakken shale oil. All right, so here we are. This is the crux of it. There's a measurement we use in chemistry. It's called the Reed vapor pressure. Anyone know what vapor pressure is? Raise your hand. Yes, sir, what is it? Very close. Thank you, sir. Very informed answer. Vapor pressure is the tendency of a chemical to want to enter into a gaseous environment, and thus it produces pressure. All right? So we have a specific measurement called the Reed vapor pressure, which measures hydrocarbon volatility. HC is hydrocarbon volatility. So typical crude oil, something you'd get out of, let's say, Louisiana, has a Reed vapor pressure of 3 to 5 PSI, pounds per square inch. Gasoline you're all familiar with gasoline, has a read vapor pressure of 9 to 10 psi. Now, if I leave my gas container in my garage, if I forget to put the lid on, the next time I go into the garage, I'll know it because I can smell it. It wants to evaporate. It's volatile. Bakken crude is nearly double the volatility of gasoline. Now remember, they've refined gasoline from crude oil. So now we're extracting crude from the ground that's actually more volatile than even gasoline. It's unbelievable. But this is how we're pulling it out of the ground. This volatility is the physical principle that brings this topic before you. There's no serious transcontinental pipeline available to move oil. Everyone heard about Keystone? Keystone, big, huge debate about Keystone. All Keystone wants to do is move oil from the Bakken field down to the Gulf states. It doesn't do anything for California, but it still would be a huge improvement in delivering oil in a safe way. I think pipelines are the way to go. I think environmentalists who oppose pipelines don't always consider all of the transportation hazards that we're going to present you with here. Of course, the next best way to get it is railroad. I certainly would never want to see road transport trucks hauling crude oil from point A to point B. So we're talking about volatility, the tendency of it wanting to vaporize. And I found this awesome little video. You know, one of these homemade chemists that videotapes doing something stupid? Well, I found this video on YouTube that it basically exemplifies what the concern is with Bakken crude. Watch this.
Okay, here I have some Bakken crude oil. I have a lighter. See that? I see it there. Now it's liquid oil, but I had it open. It's cracking the seal, and I hear its noise. And gas escaping. So, we have fire. We have oil. Oil is flammable. So, agitate it a little bit. Okay. Look at that! Look at all the natural gas coming off there. Man, it's not even burning. Burning oil, just gas. Whoop. If you want to, you agitate it a little bit more. A little hiss of gas escaping. Whoop. Look at that. Fire! Whoop. There we go. Ta-da!
There's just such a wealth of YouTube videos on chemistry. I couldn't pass this one up. So he opens up that jar, and the second time around, he goes, tss. That's why I'm here. I'm here to talk about tss. Because if it's going tss with a little jar like this that contains about an ounce of crude, what does it do when it's in a 30,000-gallon rail car? It doesn't go tss. That's what we're going to talk about. When conventional oil, we also call it heavy oil, spills or leaks, it almost never goes up in flames. Remember when Saddam went in and to Kuwait and set all the oil fields on fire? That's heavy oil, crude. He had to use weapons and ammunition and bombs and things to set those on fire. It takes a lot to get them going. 30% of Bakken crude, which is light, is made up of toxic and explosive gases. Now, the oil industry has a way to remove these gases, but when gas prices in the United States are creeping up above $4 a gallon and getting closer to $5, nobody wants to stand up and say, process your fuel. So what do? They just ship it down the road as can be. If you've been following the Bakken crude dilemma, you're going to come across this term packing group 2 and packing group 3, and I just need to go over this really quick. So DOT packing group 3 is the least hazardous properties. And of course, this is how we ship most of our Bakken crude, as a DOT packing group 3. Why? Because it has very few requirements. Now the oil companies are a little bit concerned about the PR, and they're going, okay, well, we'll make it a packing group 2. Not a whole lot change between the two. What the federal government would like them to do is call Bakken crude packing group 1. It has greatest hazardous properties, and we're going to talk about rail car problems with packing group 1 materials. Do you think that packing group 1 is what the oil companies want to use? No, it costs money. Remember, as gas prices drop, the pressures up at Williston Basin become higher and higher, and there's going to be more resistance to making any improvements because they got to make a buck. That's what they'll say. So here's our refineries. We're over here, Pad 5. This is the Petroleum Administration for Defense Districts. These pads were created in World War II as a way to ensure that we had enough oil for the war effort, and they're still around. We have three major refineries right here in Martinez in the Bay Area. We have to find a way to get those, that oil from here over here. No pipeline, right? There's no pipeline. So we use the rail. And here we are. Now SCHMRT represents six counties. Trinity County doesn't have any railroad, commercial railroad like this, but all my other counties do. If you're in Lassen or Modoc County, you have this red line, that's BNSF. You drew the lucky lottery because BNSF ships 75% of the Bakken crude out of North Dakota right now. BNSF trains are going through your jurisdiction, 100 cars at a time, all oil. Union Pacific comes down through Redding, Red Bluff, Tehama County. Union Pacific's had a different strategy. They still have 100 car trains, but they throw 10 or 15 Bakken cars on there. So when you're at the crossing, you'll notice generally the UP trains are a mixed commodity, and you will see a lot of BNSF railroads with just solid Bakken crude. They've got to get it down to this refinery down here. And here's the culprit. This is called a tanker car, a rail car, a DOT 111. It was first constructed back in the 60s. We've been complaining about DOT 111s in the fire service for about 20 years. This is not new to us. These are not well-designed cars. When they leave the car that they're on, these tanks often rupture. There's very little protection for them. By an industry standard, they're designed with 7/16 steel, aluminum, or other metals. Most other heavy-duty cars are at least 9/16. And the DOT has done very little over 25 years to make any improvements here. Now, little commentary on the site. Any railroad people in here? All right. There's some euphemism that the railroad is the fourth branch of government. And the more I work in this business, the more I realize they have infinite powers in resisting changes. Our country was largely founded on the expansion of the railroad, and there's a lot of resistance to any changes to this design. Holds 30,000 gallons, and I want you to go back to that video where the gentleman was in his kitchen, and he goes, psst. And I want you to picture this rail car full of Bakken crude, maybe in a 115 degree Redding day. There is a relief valve on top of this, obviously, but the interesting things about the older DOT 111s is they have a disc on there. because they're not designed to transport pressurized commodities. Tss means pressurized commodity. So there's a disc up there. We call it a frangible disc. And when you're moving, let's say something like water, and the surge of the product inside the tank creates a temporary overpressurizing effect, that disc breaks open. It's supposed to break open. It doesn't reseal. It breaks open and it leaves a gaping hole in the tank on top. And then an engineer comes in someday and he replaces it with another disc. And it's simply to take away that potential for overpressurizing. When you have a volatile commodity like Bakken crude, you don't want that thing open. Because now you're traveling down the railroad track and maybe the homeless encampment next to the railroad sets off a deadly disaster. The point is the DOT 111, there's something like 30,000 of them right now in service. Of all the chemicals that are moved, 69% of them are moved in DOT 111s. And it's just, it's a design that's doomed to fail. This is our concern. The DOT is just now making some changes, and we'll get into those later. But this now brings me to the point of what moving Bakken crude in these containers has done. It started on June 7, 2013. The tweets were coming out on this in Twitter, and the fire service community was absolutely in disbelief. Fire chiefs were posting, "This is not crude oil." Oh yeah. And then they another tweet would come out. Another rail car just blevied. "This is not crude oil. It's mislabeled. Something's gone wrong." No, it was crude oil. So in the town of Lac Mégantique in Quebec, the train stopped. The conductor, oh, back up 1 second. This incident happened 9 months prior. The train had a turbo leak. And when you explore human-made disasters, I want you to keep in mind that there's an endless series of cautions that if somebody at some point just put their foot down, it might not have happened. So the train had a leak in its turbo, and there's so much pressure to get this locomotive back on the rail, they patched it with epoxy, which they weren't supposed to use. Fast forward 9 months. It's been running fine until this day. The epoxy melted off and the turbo started taking oil. And so it started smoking like crazy. The engineer or the conductor called his dispatch, "What do you want me to do?" They said, "Leave the train there, go get a motel, we'll have a mechanic come fix it in the morning." He stopped the train 7 miles outside of this town on a 1% grade. Got out of the train, hired a cab, he left. There's some debate on exactly what happened or didn't happen, but the braking system failed. And this train that had 79 cars, all of them Bakken crude, rolled down towards the town. When you get into the town of Lac Mégantique, the speed limit on trains is 10 miles an hour because there's a sharp turn right in there. This train was estimated to be going 70 at a little after 1 in the morning, and it was catastrophic. 47 people were killed, most in a nightclub right there at that turn. Instantly vaporized. This is not a crude oil fire that you are accustomed to. I've got a short video, several minutes long, that I want to show you. This is at the heart of what happens when Bakken crude goes bad in a DOT 111 car. It's in French. I forgive any French speakers who might pick up on some cuss words. This is very real and very raw.
Je suis à Mégantique. On est le 4 juillet, 5 juillet, 1h30 du matin. Un train de gaz vient de prendre feu a déraillé en plein centre-ville de Mégantic. Tout le centre-ville s'en met en feu, le centre-ville au grand complet.
Fucking hell.
Oh mon Dieu. Oh là là, je vais m'éloigner là. Tout est en train de péter un par un. Je pense que je suis obligé de m'éloigner. Le feu prend une ampleur hallucinante. Karine, ça va? Ouais, écoute, là... Karine, c'est... Le centre-ville au complet est en feu. Karine, et ça continue à péter, là, parce que les... Les wagons ont pas tous pété, et puis ils pètent tous un par un, ça fait des boules de feu hallucinantes, là, le... Il y avait du monde au Music Café, Karine. J'ai croisé du monde au Music Café. Ils ont dit qu'ils ont eu le temps de courir et de sortir, donc... Oh mon Dieu. Oh mon Dieu. Je suis à 200 mètres du centre-ville. Je suis en train de prendre des images. Karine, j'ai jamais vu ça. Mais ça a juste pas de sens là, c'est... Ok, toi tu te rapproches pas, d'accord hein? Allez, c'est fou, Karine. Et Karine, c'est tout le centre-ville, là. Y a plus de centre-ville, là. Il est complètement en feu. J'ai jamais vu ça. Non, Karine, tu te rapproches pas. Sérieusement, là. T'inquiète pas pour moi, je fais attention, je te promets. Oui, t'inquiète pas pour moi, ok? Oh mon Dieu! Oh mon Dieu! Oh my God! Oh my God! Je crisse mon cœur là, je crisse mon cœur. Oh mon Dieu! Oui, oui, là, je recule là. Bye.
Alright, not to be outdone, and I'm running out of time, so I'll finish up. Right after that incident occurred, bam, Aliceville, Alabama, 3 million gallons of Bakken crude up in flames, three tanks blevied. Castleton, North Dakota, two trains collided. One was Bakken train, the other was transporting wheat. The railroad said, well, anytime you have two trains colliding, there's potential for a great disaster. That is not from wheat. Look at the size. These are rail cars over here. Look at the size of this explosion.
Well, transportation of...
Don't have time for that. Lynchburg, Virginia. Bakken crude. We were getting emails from our LAPC when this exactly happened. Two tanks blevied, seven tanks caught fire. Bakken crude. Greeley, Colorado. We didn't have an explosion or fire, but DOT 111's involved in Bakken crude derailment. Wadena, Saskatchewan. This was Bakken crude distillate, so they had already gone through the process. DOT 111 cars on fire. Can such a disaster happen in the Northstate? This is a BNSF train that's come down through Lassen and Modoc counties, and it's going through Sacramento, Bakken crude. This is a train that just went through the Feather River Canyon. 100 cars of Bakken crude, DOT 111 rail cars. For those of us on the west side of the SCHMRT district, we're pushing 100 cars of Bakken crude every single day through the Redding area down the UP line. So what's being done about it? Well, DOT's proposing all these changes to the rail car and to the procedures. I think you have handouts with all of this information. I won't go through all of this, but I want to point out a couple things. First of all, this doesn't go into effect on new cars until 2015, and there's no specification or requirement to upgrade or change existing DOT 111 cars. So the hazard still remains. Thank you very much. Any questions? And just real quick, we call this a hazmat incident. This is a firefighter incident. So my hazmat team would just be shrink wrap if we showed up to one of these things. But we will provide the technical resources needed for our local fire agencies. Thank you.
Question for Gerry. Here we go, in the back. Good question. The question is, have they set a guide number in the orange DOT emergency response guidebook, and what's the recommended evacuation distance?
The latest edition of the ERG, which is 2012, has a crude oil recommended distance, and they have not changed that, nor have they assigned a new number. That is something that's all being debated right now.
Another question. Okay. Well, the next time you are staged someplace a quarter mile or a half mile from the incident and you're grumbling because you can't see anything and they're not letting you sit where the action is, remember the video. You know, I don't understand French anymore, but I think I caught a word or two in that video. Gerry, thank you.